Psychology is all around us. Psychological elements can be seen throughout the lifespan, from birth until death. Films are a wonderful tool to explain psychological theory and occurrences in our lives. Characters interact within each frame of film's psychological concepts. The films we remember most and view multiple times engages us by capturing the presence of psychological dynamics in an authentic way. Without us even noticing, through entertainment, films foster an exploration of psychological concepts, which has the potential to expand our thoughts as to what may be possible in our lives and our relationships with others and with ourselves. I invite you to join me, Dr. Catherine Marshall Woods, licensed clinical psychologist and film consultant, and my guest today, Liza Jessie Peterson, executive producer of the film Angola, Do You Hear Us? Voices from a Plantation Prison, to discuss the best psychology in film. Today, I have the pleasure of interviewing Ms. Liza Jessie Peterson, executive producer of Angola, Do You Hear Us? Voices from a Plantation Prison. How are you today?
I'm good, thank you.
Good. It is such a pleasure to be able to speak with you because of the nature of this film and how important it is. Tell us a little bit about it before we get started.
So Angola, Do You Hear Us? Follows my trip to Angola Penitentiary, which is in Louisiana, where I performed my one-woman show, The Peculiar Patriot. And initially, the focus or the intention was to perform the play at the prison, film it, and use part of the film, for a different production, because I was doing a film of the play. And when we got down there, something else happened when I got on stage, and that created the film that is now known as Angola, Do You Hear Us, which is directed by Cinque Northern. And it's a powerful, powerful film about the impact of art and activism, and how art, what happens when art is censored, and how it really creates a ripple effect of change and activism.
Why don't we have a trailer? Why don't we take a look and we'll come right back.
Okay.
Because of the significance of the land I was on, it was more than a performance. It felt like a calling. It felt like a mission.
Angola was a plantation.
Just because you see prison with your physical eyes, what do you see beyond that?
Start questioning, why do we send people to prison? And who's actually here?
My best friend, she said, you got a story to tell. Write that shit down. And I just put the rage on the page because I had to do something.
Man, we need help.
I've been to 35 prisons across the country, but this I knew was historical. To be on a prison plantation, not just to perform, but to activate.
Everybody clung on to every word that she said.
I'm telling you, that place erupted.
You jump-started our hearts and our minds.
Here was some truth that somebody couldn't handle.
Everybody knew why it was being shut down.
When I walked out on stage, I didn't even give it any thought. It was instinctive. I said, bam. I was in the presence of a whole bunch of sleeping giants. And I said, oh, they awake now.
This trailer is so powerful for so many different reasons. Not only is it highlighting the work that you did and a little bit about what occurred while you were at the prison, but I have to say too, the music and the lighting, I mean, there's so many pieces that actually make the trailer a very powerful piece, and the film obviously as well. Tell us a little bit about what even brought you to Angola.
So I've been performing The Peculiar Patriot as a play in carceral spaces, and I've performed it in about 35 different prisons across the country. As a result of theaters not wanting to deal with the subject of mass incarceration. And then when Michelle Alexander's book came out, which is a must read for anyone, her book called The New Jim Crow, you know, the age of mass incarceration and the age of colorblindness. Well, colorblindness in the age of mass incarceration. I am really fumbling the name of the book, but it's called New Jim Crow. And that book opened up the dialogue, the national dialogue about mass incarceration. And so theaters were now suddenly interested in my work, The Peculiar Patriot. So I've always wanted to perform it at Angola Penitentiary because Angola is a plantation. Angola sits on 18,000 acres of actual plantation. It was a plantation named Angola after the enslaved Africans who were primarily from the country of Angola in Africa. And when, after slavery ended and the plantation was repurposed into a prison, they kept the nickname Angola. So Louisiana State Penitentiary is known as Angola. And my play, because it deals with mass incarceration and it makes the connection between slavery and prison, you know, the prison industrial complex, I always wanted to perform there. And so I had an opportunity to meet Norris Henderson, who was formerly incarcerated at Angola, and he's now a powerful member in the community, an activist. He has an organization called Vote NOLA, Vote New Orleans, which works with formerly incarcerated, you know, members of the community, helping them to reacclimate back into the community. But he also does amazing, powerful, impactful work with legislation, getting bills introduced, getting, you know, Jim Crow laws struck down. And so he has a political infrastructure in place that he's been boots on the ground for many years. And so when I had opportunity to meet him, and he was telling me about, you know, how Angola has a drama club, I was like, oh, my ears perked up. I said, drama club? I said, I would love to bring my play to the facility. And he arranged it. And so that's how I was able to get The Peculiar Patriot, my play, at Angola. And they allowed me to film it. So they said, oh, sure, you can film it. Which just blew my mind because, you know, getting cameras into prison is like getting cameras into, you know, the Pentagon. It's almost impossible. And so when they allowed that, that got us all of our footage of what you will see in the documentary.
Yes, a powerful piece, I must say, because, you know, I anticipated seeing was the play and you being there and your thoughts and feelings about being in the prison, but that is not exactly what you get to see. Well, you get to see that and you get to see a lot of other things that are happening within the prison system and how you are impacted by it and what then you do with all of that information. The first time I saw it, I'm thinking, this is an activist. This is, I called you a powerful force. Can you tell me, I don't want to spoil the movie for people who see it, so I'm not going to share about what happens unless you decide to do so. But tell me, what made you behave in the ways you did when you were there? Because when I say a powerful force, that's really the only way I can describe what I saw.
Yeah, so, you know, I really have to give credit to the play, because the play, The Peculiar Patriot, is such a powerful indictment of the prison industrial complex and you know, how America treats incarcerated citizens. And the play is so powerful and the play is so biting and the play is so in your face and unapologetic with its messaging that it definitely ruffles feathers and it makes certain people uncomfortable. And so that's what created the discomfort with the administration. And I don't know what it was before I even stepped foot on stage, they took away our cameras and said we couldn't film. And so that, them taking that away from me, just made me so angry. It fueled, it just put more fire to the flame that was already in the play. So now my artist, my actor, is fueled by this anger and this rage and this frustration. So I had to give it to character. You know, I had to put it into the performance. And so they felt that energy. The men in the audience felt that energy. They were laughing. They were just so, you know, activated and charged up. And the administration got shook. They got shook to the core. And they shut the production down mid-performance. And that's when everything just erupted.
You know, it's so interesting that you highlighted all these feelings that you were having when they took your cameras away and said that you couldn't use them, and how you were able to put all of those feelings into this performance. Mm. The play, you are saying, it's because the play was so, you know, engaging in these ways. I mean, you are the writer of this play, yes? So mm-hmm. where did this play come from? You know, I mean, how or where did that come from within you to actually write this play?
So I started off as a poet and an actor. And so the two have intersected in my writing. You know, a lot of my poetry is character driven and character informed. And a lot of my monologues are very poetic in nature because of the poet in me. So the poet and the actor intersect, and that they gave birth to the playwright. And I was, and I talk about this in the movie as well, that in 1998, I was asked to teach a teaching artist, to teach poetry and creative writing to incarcerated adolescent boys at Rikers Island who were 16, 17, 18 years old. And this is in 1998. So this is, you know, before Michelle Alexander's book, The New Jim Crow, had come out. And, you know, so there wasn't language. People weren't even using the term mass incarceration, as far as I know. They were calling it, you know, the prison industrial complex. So, like I said, Michelle's book just really cracked open the language and the conversation. So when I was teaching at Rikers, this is before all of that, before the national conversation. And it was a correctional officer who said to me my first week, he said, "You don't know where you are, do you?" And I said, "Yes, I'm at Rikers Island." He said, "No, you're in a modern day plantation." And he pointed to the boys who were basically primarily black and brown. He said, "They're the new crops. They're the new cotton." And he said, "When you go home, put prison industrial complex into the computer, see what you find." And he said, "And then we're going to have a conversation about it." And so he really boot kicked me down the rabbit hole. And that's when I just started, you know, finding all this information about this industry that I was, you know, immersed in. I had kind of like wandered in as a teaching artist, you know, like a deer in headlights, just coming to teach poetry. And then this whole draconian system just opened up to me. And I literally became like an evangelist because I couldn't believe that no one was screaming to the, you know, hilltops about this, you know, this human rights crisis that was in our front yard in America. And so the artist in me was just absorbing all this information. I'm teaching the boys, you know, poetry, but it's my poetry workshop turned into, you know, a political black think tank, because as I'm getting information, I'm sharing it with the boys. And so, you know, my 3-week assignment to teach this poetry workshop turned into 3 years because all the teachers kept passing me around because of the impact and the connection that I was having with the young boys. And so I became the unofficial poet in residence at Rikers Island. So all this information, all these stories, and then, you know, I also was dating someone who, you know, was caught up in the prison industrial complex. And so I'm on the bus, I'm going to visit him, I'm on the visiting room floor. So my whole life was immersed in prison. And so my cup runneth over. I won't give it away because it's in the film what triggered the writing of the play, but all this information that I was absorbing was already in me. And then, you know, as they say, my cup runneth over. And so I had to do something with it. And so it really came out like a stream of consciousness, The Peculiar Patriot. All these experiences, all this research, all this information, all these conversations just came out almost like a stream of consciousness. And that was the beginning of the birth of The Peculiar Patriot. that has now evolved into this, you know, mega play that has real life impact for incarcerated people and for families of incarcerated people.
That is such a beautiful process. And the way you describe it is also so beautiful. I can hear the poet in you. So, you know, here you are, you're doing this play at Angola in New Orleans and in Louisiana, and you have an arrangement and they say otherwise. And again, that fuels the feelings. And you say there's an eruption that happens. We don't have to talk about what that is. I hope people are going to watch the film. But I have to say, you know, I wonder how did you keep it together and actually call upon your artist self to be able to then activate you? I mean, we see all the time individuals who feel enraged or upset. How is it that you recall, or even in retrospect, you thinking about it, how did you put that and say, I know these are my feelings and I can put it and funnel it into this work?
Because there was a moment when they told us that we couldn't film, excuse me. And, you know, I was totally enraged. I was heartbroken because that was the whole purpose of me coming down there, was to film my performance of the Peculiar Patriot at this prison. And so when we're standing outside of the chapel, which is where the performance took place, and me and my team were trying to negotiate the last minute, you know, begging, trying to make it happen, saying, hey, you know, you gave us the okay. What do you mean? Like, we didn't come down here with our fingers crossed. Like, we got permission. We just couldn't roll up here with cameras. So this was all okay. So what happened? So we're out in front of the chapel. And while this is happening, all the men who are coming to see the performance are walking by us and, you know, coming into the chapel. And it was another a member of the team, a Black woman, Belinda, who is this my stage manager for the play. And so she came along to, you know, help the calling of the cues in the chapel. And she just pulled me aside and she said, look at them. She said, that's who you're here for. You're here for them. Let it go. And so when I saw all those Black men, I just pulled it together. I said, yeah, it's not about me. It's about giving them the performance. Okay, so I can't film it. So I'm just going to give them the performance because I'm here. And they came to see the play. They didn't come to see a film. They didn't come to see me filming the play. They came to see the play. So it just really shifted my consciousness and my focus to the real purpose, which is the people. This play is for the people. So it just kind of brought me back to that.
No, we have to take a break, but when we come back, I want to hear a lot more about your approach to your work. Because again, when I watch your work, I really am thinking, yes, obviously a true talent in so many ways, but also this activist that's just in you. And I would love to hear a little more about that and where you'd like to bring yourself when it comes to that. So we'll be right back after a short break.
Hi. Can I get the now bar, please?
No problem. $1.
Have a good one.
Got it.
Hi, can I get a now bar, please?
$1.
Thanks.
Hey, what's going on?
Hey.
Hey, let me get a now bar.
Sure. $1.
Appreciate you.
You got it.
How's it going?
Can I get a now bar?
Stop right there! Get down on the ground!
Out of your
car, right? Get down!
Over your head!
Get down!
I do love what I do for a living. I never dreamed that having this career was possible until I came to UDC. I met a professor when I decided to finish up my degree program. She told me, hey, why don't you go and intern on Capitol Hill? The internship led to being a staffer. I would have never been opened up to that opportunity if that professor would have never urged me and said, you know, I see something in you. My UDC experience changed my life. UDC helped me find my possible.
Find your possible. Visit udc.edu/possible to learn more.
Welcome back. We're here with Liza Jessie Peterson from Angola. Do You Hear Us? Voices from a Plantation Prison. Again, thank you so much for coming on.
Thank you for having me.
So one of the things that I noticed about your work, which I have to say for me was a passionate experience, was watching you be an activist. And I'm not sure in the moment or historically, had you considered yourself an activist? Do you consider yourself an activist?
I don't.
Okay. Say more about that, because when I watch your film, I'm thinking activist.
Yeah. No, I don't consider myself an activist. I don't call myself an activist. I call myself an artivist. So my art and activism intersect. But I'm an artist first and foremost. I'm a writer, I'm a playwright, I'm an actress. And so all of my work does have activism incorporated in it, but I'm not an activist, you know, only because I know actual activists, and that's a whole thing, you know, and I don't do that. And I'm very clear about that. But my work does intersect with activism because I am... you know, I love Black people. I love my community. I am always, you know, interested in justice and, you know, how do we heal? How do we uplift ourselves? How do we, you know, move through this oppressive, you know, system of white supremacy and to get beyond that to our Black joy and to our wholeness? So that's something that as a Black woman that I'm always interrogating and dissecting and just trying to figure out and navigating. So that informs all of my work. And so there was no way that I could be working at Rikers Island and be on the bus visiting my boyfriend at the time, seeing all these Black families, Black and brown families impacted by this draconian, you know, racist, you know, white supremacist system of mass incarceration and not have it affect me personally, and then not have it, you know, influence my art, influence my writing, and influence the actor, you know, who performs it. So it's very entwined with my personal journey as a Black woman in America.
I know we only have a little bit of time remaining, but I have to ask you, do you feel like art heals? And if so, how?
Art definitely heals. Art heals because if you look at the word art, in the middle of, if you look at the word heart, H-E-R-T, art is in the middle of the word heart. And art goes to people's heart. And when because people feel seen, people feel art, you know, in their heart chakra, they feel it first before they think it, they feel it. And when you can affect people's feelings in their heart, then you can affect their thinking and their consciousness. And if you can affect their consciousness, then you can affect their actions. So it's like a ripple effect, you know? So I would not have had the same effect if I went to Angola and I did a TED Talk. It would have been like, oh, they would have clapped, it would have been nice, but it wouldn't have pierced their heart. But they saw art. They saw themselves reflected back to them in a piece of art, in a piece of theater. And that's what activated them. That's what got them on the phones to call their family members who then voted for new candidates. And now, as a result of that play in 2020, more than 300 men have come home and been released. So that is the power of activism. That's the power of art and activism, the intersection. And so I was just so humbled and honored that my art had that kind of effect, that real life effect, that they were so activated, they were so healed, they were so inspired, they were so moved, that they were talking to each other, they were on the phone with their family members, they were telling their family members to vote for this candidate and that candidate. So two Black judges were elected, a Black sheriff, and a progressive DA. So because of the art, So Norris and his organization was able to take all of that energy that was activated, that was, you know, from the art, and they were able to harness it. And then they were able to get these candidates that they already had pointed out who were progressive, and they got them elected. So these men who could not vote, because they were activated by the art, then they activated their family members. Their family members got politically engaged, voted, got these new candidates, got these new elected officials in office who were then able to review their cases, and 300 men have come home. So that's the power of art. Does art heal? Yes. Art heals and art liberates.
Well, how can people see this film? How can people get in contact with you if they want to talk to you or
absolutely
get to learn more about this?
So Angola, Do You Hear Us? Is streaming on Paramount Plus, and it's also streaming on Amazon Prime. So Paramount Plus and Amazon Prime, you can see the film that shook Angola to its core and created an amazing impact in the community. And I'm on Instagram. My name, Liza Jessie Peterson, LizaJessie. And don't forget the I, Liza Jessie Peterson on Instagram. And my website is www.lizajessiep.com, LizaJessiep.com. And I receive emails, and you can contact me on Instagram or through my website.
If you have not seen this film, I highly recommend it. Make sure you have a moment to process. It will bring you lots of emotions, some sadness, some tears maybe, and even, I hope, a smile on your face of feeling just the power, and maybe goosebumps as well, because a lot is happening in this film. Thank you again for coming on. I appreciate it. If you want to follow me, you can find me on Instagram at SciMindedMedia. We'll see you next time. Thanks again.